Okay, now we come to Sutta number 12, Lohicha Sutta, about good and bad teachers. Thus have I heard, once the Lord was touring Kosala with a large company of some 500 monks, and coming to Salavatika, he stayed there. And at that time, the Brahmin Lohicha was living at Salavatika, a populous place full of grass, timber, water and corn, which had been given to him by King Pasanadi of Kosala as a royal gift and with royal powers. Just then this evil line of reasoning occurred to Lohicha. Suppose an ascetic or Brahmin were to discover some good doctrine. Having done so, he ought not to declare it to anyone else. For what can one man do for another? This is just as if a man, having cut through an old fetter, were to make a new one. I declare such a thing is an evil deed rooted in attachment. For what can one man do for another? Then Lohicha heard it said that the ascetic Gotama had arrived at Salavatika, and that concerning the blessed Lord Gotama, a good report has been spread about, etc., etc. And indeed, it is good to see such arahants. And Lohicha said to Basika, the barber, "Friend Basika, go to the ascetic Gotama, ask in my name after his health, and then say, may the Reverend Gotama consent to take tomorrow's meal with his Sangha of monks from the Brahmin Lohicha." "Very good, sir," said Basika, and carried out the errand. The Lord signified his acceptance by silence. Then Basika, understanding the Lord's acceptance, rose from his seat and passed by with his right side to the Lord. He returned to Lohicha and told him of the Lord's acceptance. Stop here for a moment. So here this Lohicha, he has this wrong view that if some ascetic or Brahmin were to discover some good Dhamma, he should not teach it. What can one man do for another? That is his thinking. Then after that, he heard that the Buddha had come to his place and he invited the Buddha for a meal. And the Buddha accepted by silence. That's the Buddha's way of accepting. Then the Basika, the barber, having conveyed the message, he kept his right side to the Lord and departed. This is an Indian tradition, keeping your right side to somebody shows respect. Even in our country, if you want to give something to somebody, you give it with your right hand. To give it with your left hand is impolite. Also in Thailand. And Lohicha, as the night was ending, had choice hard and soft foods prepared at his own home. Then he sent Basika to tell the Lord that the meal was ready. And the Lord, having risen early and taken his robe and bowl, went with his order of monks to Salavatika. And Basika, the barber, followed the Lord close at hand. And he said, "Lord, this evil thought has occurred to the Brahmin Lohicha." And he described that wrong view of Lohicha. "Truly, Lord, this is what the Brahmin Lohicha has been thinking." And the Buddha said, "It may well be so, Basika. It may well be so." So the Lord came to Lohicha's dwelling and sat down on the prepared seat. Lohicha personally served the Buddha and his Sangha of monks with choice hard and soft food till they were contented and satisfied. Then, when the Lord had taken his hand from the bowl, Lohicha took a low stool and sat down to one side. Then the Lord said to him, "Lohicha, is it true that an evil line of reasoning has occurred to you? Namely, suppose an ascetic or Brahmin were to discover some good doctrine. Having done so, he ought not to declare it to anyone else. For what can one man do for another? It is just as if a man, having cut through an old fetter, were to make a new one. I declare that such a thing is an evil deed rooted in attachment. For what can one man do for another?" And Lohicha said, "Yes, Reverend Gotama." "What do you think, Lohicha? Don't you reside at Salavatika?" "Yes, Reverend Gotama." "Well now, if anyone should say, the Brahmin Lohicha resides at Salavatika, and he should enjoy the entire fruits and revenues of Salavatika, not giving anything away to others. Would not anyone who spoke like that be a source of danger to your tenants?" And Lohicha said, "He would be a source of danger, Reverend Gotama. And as such, would he be solicitous for their welfare or not?" "He would not, Reverend Gotama. And not being solicitous for their welfare, would he have a heart full of love for them or of hatred?" "Of hatred, Reverend Gotama." "And in a heart full of hatred, is there wrong view or right view?" "Wrong view, Reverend Gotama." "But Lohicha, I declare that wrong view leads to one of two destinies, hell or an animal rebirth." Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha is trying to show that Lohicha has wrong view. So he says, now, if following your line of thought, that whatever you obtain, you should not share with others, then you should not share your revenue to anyone else, and even to those of your tenants. Then that being so, would it not be dangerous for your tenants? He said yes, so he had to admit. And then he's finally, the Buddha shows him that this is wrong view. And the Buddha said that wrong view leads to one of two destinies, either rebirth in hell or the animal realm. What do you think, Lohicha? Does King Parsanadi of Kosala reside at Kasi Kosala? He does, Reverend Gotama. Well, if anyone should say King Parsanadi of Kosala resides at Kasi Kosala, and he should enjoy the entire fruits and revenues of Kosala, not giving anything away to others, would anyone who spoke like that be a source of danger to his tenants? Would he have a heart full of hatred? And would that not be wrong view? It would, Reverend Gotama. Then surely, if anyone were to say the same of the Brahmin Lohicha, that would be wrong view. In the same way, Lohicha, if anyone should say, suppose an ascetic or Brahmin, stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha says, if using your view, then that means if an ascetic knows something he should not share with others, then King Parsanadi should not share his revenue and his land and wealth with anyone else, including even you. Then he realized, it's true. In the same way, Lohicha, if anyone should say, suppose an ascetic or Brahmin were to discover some good doctrine and thought he ought not to declare it to anyone else, for what can one man do for another? He would be a source of danger to those young men of good family who, following the Dhamma Vinaya taught by the Tathagata, attain to such excellent distinction as to realize the fruit of stream entry, of one's returning, of non-returning, of arhanship, and to all who ripen the seeds of a rebirth in the Deva world. Being a source of danger to them, he is uncompassionate and his heart is grounded in hostility, and that constitutes wrong view, which leads to hell or the animal rebirth. And if anyone were to speak thus of King Parsanadi, he would be a source of danger to the king's tenants, yourself and others, etc. Okay. Lohicha, these three kinds of teachers in the world are blameworthy. And if anyone blames such teachers, his blame is proper, true, in accordance with reality and faultless. Which three? Here, Lohicha is a teacher who has gone forth from the household life into homelessness, but who has not gained the goal of asceticism. And without having gained this goal, he teaches his disciples a doctrine, saying, "This is for your good, this is for your happiness." But his pupils don't wish to hear, they don't listen, they don't arouse the thought of enlightenment, and the teacher's instructions are flouted. He should be blamed, saying, "This venerable one has gone forth," etc., etc., and his instructions are flouted. It is just as if a man were to persist in making advances to a woman who rejected him and to embrace her though she turned away. This I declare to be an evil doctrine based on attachment. For what can one man do for another? This is the first teacher who is blameworthy. Stop here for a moment. So just now, Lohicha basically was saying, if some ascetic or Brahmin knows something, he should not teach to others. So Buddha at first showed him that not sharing anything with others is wrong lah. But now the Buddha is trying to also show that there are certain teachers that who should not try to teach others, who should not try to share what they know with others because of certain reasons. The first one is he has not gained the goal of asceticism. He has not gained the fruits of the holy life. And he has not attained the fruits of the holy life. Then he teaches others. People will not listen to him. People have no respect for him. So this one is, first one is an unqualified teacher. For example, also there are some people, they are very good at preaching, but they don't practice what they preach. So what is the, he's talking about the goal of asceticism. What is the goal of asceticism? I think the goal of asceticism are those things said by the Buddha to be Uttari Manusa Dhamma. Uttari Manusa Dhamma. Manusa is humans, human beings. Uttari is higher than human being. Dhamma is states. States higher than the ordinary human being. In other words, supernormal states. And what are these supernormal states? In the Vinaya, one is jhana. Jhana, the four jhanas, any one of the four jhanas also is Uttari Manusa Dhamma. And then psychic powers that come with the attainment of the four jhanas. And then including liberation. And then the paths and fruits of Aryahood. The first path, the first fruit, second fruit, third path, third fruit, fourth path, fourth fruit. And only the fourth fruit is a liberated person. The others are partially liberated. So these are the goals of asceticism, goals of the holy life. The aim of the holy life is to achieve these states called Uttari Manusa Dhamma, supernormal or higher than human, normal human attainments. So this person, he has not attained anything. Probably he just become a monk. There are some people like that. They just become a monk and they quickly want to teach. But they are not qualified to teach. So because they are not qualified to teach, people don't listen to him. Again, there is a teacher who has gone forth, but who has not gained the goal of asceticism. Without having gained this goal, he teaches his disciples a doctrine saying, this is for your good, this is for your happiness. His pupils wish to hear, they listen, they arouse the thought of enlightenment, and the teacher's instructions are not flouted. He should be blamed, saying, this venerable one has gone forth, etc., etc. But has not gained the goal of asceticism. And without gaining the goal, he teaches his disciples. It is as if leaving his own field, he should think that another's field is in need of weeding. I declare this to be an evil doctrine rooted in attachment. This is the second teacher who is blameworthy. I'll stop here for a moment. So here again, this second monk has not attained any of the fruits of the holy life. And he teaches. But people listen to him. People listen to him and heed his instructions. But then the Buddha says, this teacher is blameworthy. Because if the teacher has not cultivated himself, initially his followers may have a lot of faith in him. But later, he will, because he has not cultivated himself, it's likely that he will do something wrong, break the precepts, or even break the major precepts, and then people lose faith in him, or he disrobes or something. So, in the suttas, the Buddha says that it is good for a monk to teach, or to learn the Dhamma, but the Buddha says that it is important for a monk to allot a certain time to go into seclusion and practice meditation. If a monk only teaches but does not practice himself, it's just like the Buddha says here. This farmer, instead of looking after his own field, he goes to tend to another person's field. Again, there is a teacher who has gone forth and who has gained the goal of asceticism. Having gone forth, he teaches, but his pupils don't wish to hear him. His instructions are flouted. He too should be blamed. Just as if having cut through an old fetter, one were to make a new one. I declare that this is an evil doctrine rooted in attachment. For what can one man do for another? This is the third teacher who is blameworthy. These are the three kinds of teacher that I spoke of as blameworthy. Third teacher, he has gained a certain goal of asceticism, and he starts teaching. But maybe he has not prepared himself well enough, so people don't listen to him. The Buddha says, but if he still insists on teaching, wants to teach, even though people don't welcome his teaching, then he's blameworthy. As far as the Dhamma is concerned, normally, a monk should preach the Dhamma or teach the Dhamma when requested. If not requested, he should be careful, because sometimes people might not appreciate. Sometimes even not invited, a monk gives advice. If it's appreciated, then it's okay, but not if it's not appreciated. So also we must realize, the Buddha says, very few people are interested in the true Dhamma, because the true Dhamma involves cultivating yourself, making effort, letting go of your faults, your bad habits and all that, which a lot of people are not willing to let go. A lot of people still want to enjoy the world and all this thing. A lot of people are not interested in the true Dhamma. That's why Buddhas, 99.99% of Buddhas are Pacheka Buddhas. The Buddha looked into the past 91 world cycles and he saw only six Sammasambuddhas willing to teach the Dhamma to the world. Whereas the Buddha said at one time, outside Rajagaha, Wang Se Cheng, there is a mountain called Isigili Mountain. And the Buddha said at one time there were 500 Pacheka Buddhas there. So you see, one time only you can find 500 Pacheka Buddhas. But 91 world cycles, you can only find 6 Sammasambuddhas. So 99.99% of Buddhas are Pacheka Buddhas. A lot of people don't realize this. And they make vows to become Buddha and all that, want to teach the world. But actually when they become a Buddha, they don't want to teach. Then Lohicha said, Reverend Gotama, are there any teachers in the world who are not blameworthy? And the Buddha said, here Lohicha, a Tathagata arises in the world, an Arahant, Sammasambuddha, endowed with wisdom and conduct, welfarer, knower of the worlds, incomparable trainer of men to be tamed, teacher of gods and humans, enlightened and blessed. He, having realized it by his own super knowledge, proclaims this world with his devas, maras and brahmas, its princes and people. He preaches the Dhamma, which is lovely in its beginning, lovely in its middle, lovely in its ending, in the spirit and in the letter, and displays the fully perfected and purified holy life. A disciple goes forth and practices the moralities, guards the sense doors, etc., attains the first jhana. And whenever the pupil of a teacher attains to such an excellent distinction, that is a teacher who is not to be blamed in the world. And if anyone blames that teacher, his blame is improper, untrue, not in accordance with reality and faulty. Similarly, he attains the other three jhanas and various insights, abhinya. And whenever the pupil of a teacher attains to such excellent distinction, that is a teacher who is not to be blamed in the world. He realizes the four noble truths, the path, the cessation of the corruptions, the asavas, etc. Whenever the pupil of a teacher attains to such excellent distinction, that is a teacher who is not to be blamed in the world. And if anyone blames that teacher, his blame is improper, untrue, not in accordance with reality and faulty. At this, the Brahmin Lohicha said to the Lord, Reverend Gautama, it is as if a man were to see someone by the hair who had stumbled and was falling into a pit, and to set him on firm ground. Just so I, who was falling into the pit, have been saved by the Reverend Gautama. Excellent, Reverend Gautama, excellent. It is as if someone were to set up what had been knocked down, or to point out the way to one who had got lost, or to bring an oil lamp into a dark place so that those with eyes could see what was there. Just so the Reverend Gautama expounded the Dhamma in various ways. I go for refuge to the Lord Gautama, the Dhamma and the Sangha. May the Reverend Gautama accept me as a lay follower who has taken refuge from this day forth for as long as life shall last. That's the end of the sutta. So here the Buddha says that if a teacher teaches and the disciple can attain these Uttari Manusa Dhamma, these states which are higher than the normal human being, namely the jhanas, the abhinyas or higher knowledges and liberation, then the teacher is not to be blamed. So going back to the three teachers who are blameworthy, the first one has not attained any of this goal of the holy life. The second one also has not attained. The third one has attained, but people don't want to listen to him for various reasons. For example, maybe he has attained jhana. But there are some people who have a knack for teaching. Some people have no knack for teaching. Some people, the way they speak, people don't like. The Buddha says in the suttas that a teacher should be able to speak very clearly so that people can understand. He should speak slowly. Not everybody is able to do that. So this teacher, this third one, who is blameworthy, just attained something, but he doesn't have the ability to teach. So people don't want to listen to him. So that's why he's blameworthy. But if he can teach his disciple to attain, any teacher can teach the disciple to attain the jhanas or the abhinyas, various types of psychic power, and attain the paths and the fruits, then he is not blameworthy. So this is a very important point, because nowadays in the world, there are many who disparage jhana. Even so-called meditation teachers nowadays, they put down jhana. I know a certain famous meditation teacher in his book, he said, what's the point of cultivating jhana? He said, when you attain jhana, you don't have mindfulness. Only when you come out of jhana, you have mindfulness. That shows he doesn't understand what is jhana, and also shows he has not attained jhana. And yet, he's a famous meditation teacher in the world. A lot of people, because they don't listen to the Buddha's suttas, study the Buddha's words, then they don't know that a lot of teachers that they follow are teaching contradictory to what the Buddha says. That's why I always stress that it's very important to be familiar with the suttas. The Buddha said very clearly that if any monk says the Buddha taught in such and such a way, the Buddha said not to accept and not to reject it, but to compare it with the suttas. Only if it follows the suttas can you accept it to be the Buddha's teachings. So the goal of the holy life, of the spiritual path, is basically the jhanas, the four jhanas, and the various knowledges, and the paths and fruits of Aryahood. The paths and fruits of Aryahood are the most important, more important than the jhanas and the psychic powers. Because once you attain the paths and fruits, you are an Arya. And once you're an Arya, you cannot go backwards, you cannot regress, you cannot fall, you cannot even be reborn into the woeful planes of existence. And you're sure of liberation. And they're not at the most, seven lifetimes, you will attain liberation. So here, finally, Lohicha said, it's as if a man were to see someone by the hair who had stumbled and was falling into a pit and to set him on firm ground. Just so, I, who was falling into the pit, have been saved by the Reverend Gotama. So here, because the Buddha said, a person with wrong view will only have two types of rebirth, either hell or the animal realm. Then he realized he has been saved from the hell and the animal realm by the Buddha. So he showed his appreciation. So, we've gone through two suttas for tonight, and that's enough. Probably you have a lot of questions tonight. So these two suttas are quite important. The Kivada Sutta describes state of cessation where consciousness ceases, which is basically the state of Parinibbana after the Arahant has passed on. And then the Lohicha Sutta talking about teachers who are blameworthy and teachers who are not blameworthy. Any question? Yeah.
There could only be one Buddha at the time. So does that mean in the world cycle or at the present moment?
At the present moment, the Buddha says, at any one time, there can only be one Sammasambuddha at the present moment. So like in this world cycle, on this present earth, the Buddha said there will be five Sammasambuddha. The first one was Kakusanda, then Konagamana, and then Kasapa, and then now the Buddha Gautama, and the future will be Maitreya Buddha or Maitreya Buddha.
So only all one
Sammasambuddha
and one Pachekabuddha,
but there
were 10 at one
time? Say again?
Only one
Pachekabuddha
at the time.
No, one Sammasambuddha.
Sammasambuddha at the time. What about Pachekabuddha? There were 10 at the time?
Oh, can be 500, the Buddha said. Can be hundreds of them. External ascetics, without practicing the Noble Eightfold Path, they can attain the fourth jhana. But the difference is that the jhana they attain is the un-Aryan jhana. The Buddha said the Aryan Samadhi or Aryan jhana is jhana supported by the seven factors of the Noble Eightfold Path. So there's a difference between Aryan Samadhi and un-Aryan Samadhi. So un-Aryan Samadhi, because it is not supported by the seven factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, it does not lead to liberation. Whereas the Aryan Samadhi, which is the four jhanas, supported by the seven factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, leads to liberation. What the Buddha is trying to say is what can one man do for another is that if you are not qualified, how can you help another? The Buddha said, if a person is in the mud, how can he help another person out of the mud? He has to get out of the mud before he can help a person out of the mud. So the Buddha basically is saying that if a person is not qualified, what can he do for another? Who is speaking? Are you talking about Lohicha or are you talking about the Buddha? No, this is wrong view. This is the Lohicha's wrong view that if a person has discovered good doctrine, he should not teach. This is not the Buddha's words. This is Lohicha's words. They are very different from the Buddha's words. The Buddha is using his words, just using his words, basically to say that there is a case, what can one man do for another if he is not qualified? So suppose you are not qualified in medicine, and then you try to heal another person. You're not qualified to heal him. So the Buddha is saying Lohicha has a wrong view. In the Dhammapada, the Buddha said, the giving of Dhamma is the highest gift. But here Lohicha is saying, if you have the Dhamma, you should not teach others.
You mean Monday? I'm just referring to this one on the Sutta number, I think it's 11, what Brahma didn't know. Now, when the monk said, the way to the four great elements, the earth element, water element, fire element, and the air element, sees without the rain. Is he asking about when the world is coming to an end? Because if I remember last year, in one of the suttas, I think you were mentioning something about when the world system as we know will come to an end when it's at the moment you have one son, then second you have two, and three. By the time we come to the seven, the system, the earth as we know it, will explode. Is he referring to the same thing?
No. He's referring to where the world has no opportunity to arise. But this one, when you say end of the world, this world system ends. There are many other world systems. But here he's saying totally has no samsara, no universe at all. As I mentioned before, the world exists in consciousness, right? So, to end the world, you must end the consciousness.
Water,
fire, and air, no Buddhist found fine. Is this referring to Nama Rupa? Because the Buddhist gets is in consciousness.
Yeah, there it says, where are Nama Rupa wholly destroyed? So, the four great elements also inside.
when the world cycles end, is there just like one nirvana, or is there for each world cycle? Is there...
No, when we say the world ends, we are talking about a one world system. The Buddha says one world system consists of a sun. So every star that you see in the sky, every star is a world system. And every star will have human beings, I mean around the star. Just like our star is the sun. So there are planets around the sun. And there will be human beings. So there will be other world systems that have human beings, that have devas, similar devas and devis. So when that world ends, only that world ends, others will still be around. That is not Nibbana.
But
In India, there are two schools of thought. One is if you want to practice a spiritual path, you have to develop your body first, and they do yoga exercises. So yoga, asanas and all these things to strengthen the body, and they can control their breathing, they can even control the heartbeat and all these things. And the other line of thought is like the Buddha. The Buddha does not talk about the necessity to develop your body. He goes straight into the spiritual practice. But the Buddha says that walking meditation is good. And also, if you look into the life of the Buddha and the monks, you find that they go on arms round, beg for their food. So that is very healthy, because they walk barefooted, and you'll be stepping on pebbles and sand and all that. That's reflexology. And then, not only that, the monks have to do work in the monastery. If you look into the Vinaya books, you find that at one time, during the 3 months of the Vasa, Venerable Mahamoggallana with a team of monks, they were building kutis. They are building many kutis. So a lot of people, they think monks should only meditate and not work. No, because if everybody meditates, then who's going to maintain the monastery? There are some monks, of course, they don't want to work. They only want to meditate. That's good. Then they have to live alone. Live alone in a cave or something, then the cave can be very dirty. Last time I stayed in a cave, there's a lot of bats. You know, in dark caves, there's a lot of bats. And there'll be a lot of bat shit all around. So you just have to... don't bother about the bat shit and the snakes and all that. Just meditate on it. No, because I don't stay in an enclosed cave with all the smell. You got to stay in a well-ventilated cave.
Is there a reason why a lot of forest monasteries,
the kutis
are located on a hill?
Located on a hill. A hill is a good place to have a monastery, firstly because it's not flooded, and secondly because if there's a little hill, then it's more windy. Low ground is always, the air is stagnant. There's some monasteries on low ground, but it's very stagnant. And also, because if you want to go away from the town, then you go to the countryside. It's liable to have hills. Ninth and tenth precept for a samanera. The ninth precept is mala ganda vilepana darana mandana vibhusanatana. That one is not seeing shows. Wait, let me see. The first one is not seeing shows. The eighth one is Nacha Gita Vadita Visuka Dasana Malaganda Vilepana Dharana Mandana Vibhusanatana. The eighth one is not to see shows, listen to music, sing and dance and all this. The ninth one is not to adorn yourself, use perfume, makeup and all this thing. And the tenth one is not to possess money. There's a difference between the eight precepts and the ten precepts. In the eight precepts, the seventh precept consists of two precepts. Not to see shows, not to sing and dance and all these things. And also the other precept, not to adorn your body, use cosmetic and perfume and all these things. Two precepts are found in the seventh precept of the eight precepts. But these two precepts, in the ten precepts, they are broken up into the, the seven precept and the eight precept. And then the nine precept is the Ucha Sayana, Maha Sayana, not to sleep on luxurious bed. And then the ten precept is not to possess money. But they are not taking the eight precepts, ma.
But they are not supposed to be through the show.
Mm-hmm. The monks are singing, ma.
Even if they attend the function.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, of course, they are doing them. So, who is taking the precepts?
In that case, sometimes it's for the purpose of supporting the Sunday school. They do it, it's different. No. That's why there's, when a person attains Sotapanna, three fetters are abandoned. One is Sakaya Ditti, which is identity view. Identity view means identifying the body and the mind with the self. And then another one is doubt. Doubt about the Buddha, Dharma and Sangha. The third one is Sila Bhatta Paramasa. Attachment to rules and rituals. Actually, attachment to Sila and rituals. So, if a person is attached to rules, even sila, and you don't understand there is a purpose for sila, then you cannot be a sotapanna. You must understand what is the purpose of the sila. Don't be seipan. So we must understand. So don't be too rigid. There are some monks, small things, they're too fussy. Even water has got to be offered. But in the Vinaya books, water and toothpick don't have to be offered. Okay, shall we end here?